Namaste and warm welcome to you all to this brief presentation on Postmethod Pedagogy and its applicability in the context of Nepal. It's really an honor and privilege for me to be with you all to present on Postmethod Pedagogy. So I would like to discuss the overview of today's presentation. Presentation overview, background, historical background of English language teaching, an introduction of post-method pedagogy, three parameters of post-method pedagogy that include pedagogy of particularity, pedagogy of practicality, and pedagogy of possibility. Similarly, I will highlight some of the important aspects of learner's autonomy, teacher's autonomy, and teacher educator's autonomy under indicators of post-method pedagogy. Similarly, Kumara Badhuvelu has outlined 10 macro strategies. Based on them, the teachers can adopt different strategies in the classroom. Background. Nepal has the total area of 147,181 square kilometer, which was set after the Treaty of Sugauli was signed on 2nd December 1815, and it was endorsed by 4th March 1816. The total population of Nepal, according to the Nepal Census 2011, is 2,64,94,504. In Nepal, there are more than 125 ethnic communities that speak 129 languages, according to Central Bureau of Statistics 2012. And out of total languages, 60% of them are on the verge of extinction, which has been mentioned by Gautam 2019. In Nepal, Nepali speaking, the Nepali language is used as a mother tongue by 45% people. This is also reported by Central Bureau of Statistics 2012. The historical background of English language teaching in Nepal. Jang Bahadur visited Europe from 15 January 1850 to 29 January 1851. After his return from Europe visit, he established Darbari School in 1854 in Nepal. Darbari School is also known as the foundation of formal schooling system, though there were some Sanskrit parsalas as well as some gumbaz where Sanskrit and then Tibetan would be the medium of instructions in those parsalas and gumbaz. English language teaching is actually the idea brought by Jang Bahadur Rana, which has been mentioned by Rana 2018. Darbari School was not open to all the public until 1885. Then Chandra Samsir, the first matriculation graduate in Nepal, he established Tri Chandra College in 1918. After that, Ministry of Education was established by the then King Tribhuvan in 1951. During Rana period, there were some religious schools, Hindu parsalas and Buddhist gompas using the mediums of Sanskrit and Tibetan respectively. So rather than discussing more on the background, I would directly like to discuss on post-method pedagogy. According to Kumara Badhuvelu, post-method pedagogy is a search for an alternative to method rather than an alternative method. So it's not alternative to method. So he wants to go beyond the method-based restrictions, that is the methods propounded, developed by the theorists, by the researchers, by the linguists are of no more use in the real classroom, because the context differs, because the particular group of people differ, particular group of learners differ, particular condition, socio-political situation, milieu differs, and because of which the theories, methods developed by the theorist in one corner of the world may not be equally applicable in all other parts of the world. That's why to avoid the method-based restriction, post-method pedagogy was outlined. Post-method condition enables practitioners to produce local, specific and noble practices which can be developed by the teachers themselves. So post-method pedagogy is a three-dimensional system with three pedagogic parameters. They are pedagogy of particularity, pedagogy of practicality, and pedagogy of possibility. And post-method pedagogy is different from eclecticism. In eclecticism, what we do is we bring some bits of information from different methods that are applicable in the classroom. And when we bring these informations, pieces of information from different methods, they remain unprincipled, they remain uncritical, and so they may not be very much useful in a particular context. Rather, when a teacher theorizes from what he practices and practices what he theorizes, then this becomes very useful. So post-method therefore is a construction of classroom procedures and principles by the teacher herself based on his or her prior and experimental knowledge and her certain strategies. There are three features of post-method condition. It's a search for an alternative to method rather than an alternative method. Similarly, teacher autonomy, because the teacher has the potential to know how to teach, how to handle the problems that arise in the classrooms, as well as it is also about enabling and empowering teachers. Then principled pragmatism is there. Post-method pedagogy goes against unsystematic, uncritical, and unprincipled pedagogy. It does not regard eclecticism as a good strategy for a teacher. No eclecticism, that is to putting together a package of techniques from various methods, rather than the teachers has the potential to find out the useful methods based on his own practice. There are three parameters of post-method pedagogy. They are pedagogy of particularity, pedagogy of practicality, and pedagogy of possibility. The parameter of particularity requires that any language pedagogy must be sensitive to a particular group of teachers, teaching a particular group of learners, pursuing a particular set of goals within a particular institutional context, embedded in a particular socio-cultural milieu. This is what Kumarabadibelu mentions in 2003. Local educational, institutional, and social context have to be duly considered, because teaching is always context-sensitive activity. All pedagogy, like all politics, is local. So local needs, local interest, local resources should be taken into account while teaching. Then pedagogy of practicality. This parameter of practicality refers to the relationship between theory and practice and the practice of classroom teaching. The teacher is not merely the consumer of the theories, methods developed by the linguist, developed by the theorist in one of the context of the world, because these theories, these methods may not be equally applicable in another part of the world. That's why what he suggests is the teacher should be able to theorize from what he practices and should practice what he theorizes. So teachers can theorize through reflective teaching and through action research. Action researches are carried out generally to improve the practice of teaching and learning in the classroom. Teachers are not merely the consumers of the theories. Teachers can become better researchers with regard to the classroom problems and professions. It is also related to encouraging and enabling teachers themselves to theorize from their practice and practice what they theorize. A pedagogy practicality aims for a teacher-generated theory of practice, and through action researches, through reflective practices, that is by writing teachers' journals, by asking survey questions, through observations, by asking the colleague to observe the teacher's class and then to give a very constructive feedback. Through these reflective practices can be done, and based on them the practices can be theorized. Pedagogy of possibility. This pedagogy of possibility is based on the Brazilian philosopher's idea, Paulo Freire's idea of education for critical consciousness, and pedagogy of the oppressed kind of works. This is based on, as well as of American critical educationist Henry Giroux and Roger I. Simon's works. Pedagogy is associated to power and dominance and is implemented to create and sustain social inequality generally, because even in the classrooms also, those who are talented, those who are neat and tidy, those who sit on the first benches, they are focused in the classrooms. Rather, the post-method teacher should go against this and then should empower all equally. So pedagogy of possibility is concerned with raising critical consciousness among the learners. It is concerned with the individual identity of the learners, teachers, and then to empower the participants considering the learners' experiences, because they have varied backgrounds. They have come from different linguistic, cultural, social, religious, economic background, and a teacher, post-method teacher, should use these varied backgrounds as assets in the classroom. Similarly, Kumara Badibelu also talks about the indicators of post-method pedagogy. They are learners' autonomy, teachers' autonomy, and teachers' educators' autonomy. Learners' autonomy are of two types, that is academic and liberatory. A learner is free to choose cognitive, metacognitive, and affective techniques. He or she has different or varied strategies and styles of learning, so he or she should be given freedom in choosing so. Similarly, liberatory autonomy is about empowering the learners to be critical thinkers. The teacher's main job is to, you know, make the students able to ask questions in the classroom, as well as involving them to continuous observation of the world. As teacher's autonomy means the teacher is free to select and develop the techniques and methods of language teachings. The teacher is always able to bring changes in the pedagogy. Similarly, the teacher is a resourceful and encourages learners to be critical thinkers. So there must be praxis-based teaching and learning, and the teaching and learning should not be one-sided. The teacher always speaks thinking that the students are the empty vessels that can be filled with the knowledge. The teacher can deposit the knowledge into the student's mind. So banking model of teaching is avoided by a post-method teacher. Similarly, there will be constant involvement in teacher research and desire of self-explore and self-improve too. Teacher educators' autonomy, unlike in the traditional way of giving training to the teachers, in teacher the teacher educator or teacher trainer does not follow the top-down approach of educating the teachers. Rather, he or she thinks that the teacher knows a lot of things, that the teacher has knowledge of language teaching and learning. The teacher is experienced one. The teacher has different skills to adopt in the classrooms too, has potential to handle the classroom problems. And so teacher educator always encourages to think critically, make decisions, to theorize their practice and practice what they theorize. It enables similarly, teacher educator enables teachers to articulate their voices and vision. So as well as the teacher educator always remains in the constant dialogic engagement with the teachers. Strategic frameworks. Kumara Badibelu outlines 10 strategic frameworks, macro strategies, and based on these macro strategies, the teachers can adopt different strategies, techniques in the classrooms for better teaching, for effective teaching, maximize learning opportunities. And the teachers are the creators of the learning opportunities for the learners, as well as the utilizer of the learning opportunities developed by the learners. Facilitated negotiated interactions is another strategic framework, that is macro strategy. The interaction takes place between learners and teacher. And these interactions must be meaningful ones. Minimize perceptual mismatches. The intentions and interpretations may differ between learners, teachers, educators. The teachers always helps them understand better, clarifies intentions and interpretations. Active intuitive heuristics, that means the teacher provides a text which is rich in both governing grammatical usage and communicative use. Similarly, postural language awareness. This strategy involves any attempt to draw learners' attention to the formal and functional properties of their L2 in order to increase the degree of explicitness required to promote L2 learning. Contextualized linguistic input. This strategy highlights how language is said and shaped by linguistic, extra-linguistic, and situational and extra-situational context, that is, making the discussion meaningful, making the interaction meaningful in the classroom. similarly integrate language skills rather than teaching language skills separately. The post method teacher teaches language skills integratively listening, speaking, reading and writing are emphasized and are taught integratively. Promote learner autonomy, and that means to help the learners learn how to learn, equipping them with the means necessary to self-direct and self-monitor their own learning. Another macro strategy is raise cultural consciousness, that is treating learners as cultural informants so that they are encouraged to engage in a process of classroom participation that puts a premium on their power and knowledge. At present, in traditional methods, what we do is we expect that our students should follow the mainstream, that is, should speak the language, the medium of instruction, in which medium we teach. The students are always encouraged to speak that rather than encouraging them to speak their home language or mother tongue. So these kind of things should be revisited according to this strategy and ensure social relevance. That is, this strategy stresses the need for the teachers to be sensitive to the societal, political, economic and educational environment in which L2 learning and teaching takes place. So very context sensitive we have to be, and we have to make the teachers should make the students to think critically. These are some of the works that I consulted while preparing this presentation. Thank you very much for listening to me so patiently.